first-person shooter games are ubiquitous these days. The big names of today include the established behemoth multiplayer franchises like Call of Duty, Battlefield, Counter-Strike, and Halo. We can also look at some of the relative newcomers to the scene that have become large brands as well, like Overwatch, Valorant, and Apex Legends. These are all giant brands that are seen and played everywhere. What about single-player first-person shooters? One can point to franchises like Far Cry, Half-Life, and the Doom series. Any discussion about the first-person shooter genre will inevitably bring up talk about the original Doom game, created by the company id Software in 1993, and for good reason. Doom and its immediate successor, Doom 2, are heavily credited as two of the games that defined and popularized the first-person shooter as a genre. And in fact, the initial first-person shooter action games that came out in the first couple of years after Doom were usually referred to as Doom clones. The term first-person shooter would not supersede Doom clone in usage until about 1998 or so, when so many Doom clones were coming out that it became evident they weren't clones anymore. These were games that fell under a new style, and a new genre. Still, Doom's influence on the video game industry as a whole cannot be understated, as the conventions it established for first-person shooters are everywhere today, almost 30 years later. What is the significance of a game being played from the first-person perspective? A first-person game is a game where you control a character and view the game world through their eyes. These games are meant to be more immersive experiences, helping players experience fantastical stories and events as if they were the one in the game world themselves. Things happen to you in the game, and you respond, putting yourself in the shoes of an avatar representing yourself. You usually don't see much of them beyond their arms and hands to simulate how you see things in real life. After all, unless you look into a mirror, a person can't see their own face. At the same time, you can take initiative and do things to the world, which then responds in kind. So what is a first-person shooter? It seems to be a pretty straightforward question to answer. First-person shooters are just games played in the first-person perspective, but with added mechanics that involve clicking on things or enemies in the world that eliminates them and allows for progression in some form, and this is usually done with a gun of some kind. After the immense cultural impact the first two Doom games made in defining this new FPS genre, the series fell somewhat out of the limelight. Two more mainline games were released, Doom 64 in 1997 for the Nintendo 64, and Doom 3 in 2004. While generally well-received, these games were not the cultural phenomena that the original first two games were. Finally, over 20 years later, after 1993's Doom, the franchise began a bit of a renaissance era in 2016, in a time when nostalgia for the prior two decades had begun to grow. First came a game simply called Doom, as it was intended to be a soft reboot for the franchise, although most people refer to it as Doom 4 or Doom 2016. I'll be referring to it as Doom 2016 from now on. Doom Eternal then followed in 2020. Both games received generally critical acclaim for bringing the more old-school, fast-paced, arena-style of FPS gameplay into the modern day. The 2016 game, especially, was perceived as a return to form for the franchise as a whole, and as a return to the old days, when Doom and Doom 2 stood out as exceptional first-person shooter experiences. However, some new fans who had discovered the franchise through Doom 2016 took notice of things Doom Eternal did differently from the 2016 title, beyond just gameplay elements. For example, the 2020 sequel features a far more involved story than any of its predecessors, including several cutscenes that take control away from the player, in which you can also often see the player avatar, aka Doom Guy or the Doom Slayer, from a third-person perspective. There are pages and pages of exposition and lore on the Doomslayer's history, describing where he came from and how he ended up interacting with alien races and godlike figures, alongside the demons. You are also often able to see his face through his helmet's visor during these more cinematic cutscenes as characters spoke to or interacted with him. Certain events and audio logs in the game serve to worship your character as a godlike being and make you, the player, feel powerful, alongside the usual first-person shooter gameplay elements. At the same time, however, the game was further separating the Doomslayer from the player, treating him more and more like his own character. It happened frequently enough that people found it strange and sometimes immersion-ruining. In Doom 2016, these features didn't seem to be nearly as present. In fact, the perspective of the 2016 game essentially never left the first-person point of view. Even in the moments where you couldn't leave a room, had to listen to exposition, or were in a cutscene, character still spoke to and interacted with you, protagonist and player as one. You were almost always in control of your character, and it felt more like the character was you, the player. There was also much less exposition. The game even made jokes about how you as the Doomslayer character didn't care at all for the overarching lore. One character in particular would frequently dump information and instructions on you, and you would ignore them and focus on the main mission of just killing demons. The game was aware on some meta level that it was just an arcadey game about destroying monsters, and let you just be someone playing that game in the game world.
Welcome. I'm Dr. Samuel Hayden. I'm the head of this facility. I think we can work together and resolve this problem in a way that benefits us both.
Some fans weren't sure if they liked these things that Eternal did differently. It seemed to be deviating from what made Doom 2016 great as a first-person shooter, where you as the player and character were always the one in control and could focus on the core gameplay loop of just ripping and tearing through hordes of demons. Perhaps Eternal could even be seen as deviating from the established rules of the original Doom from all those years ago. So what rules did Doom establish? Let's go back to where it all started in 1993. Very little exposition and story is given for Doom when the player starts the game, but the goal seems to be clear pretty quickly. You're dropped into some kind of facility holding what looks to be a gun. There are some bloodied human corpses lying around the area, and you run into some demonic-looking figures that shoot at you and hurt your health. Soon you put two and two together and realize you're supposed to shoot back. So you point the floating gun barrel on your screen at the evil-looking dude in front of you, click, and get some nice visual and auditory feedback to let you know you just ended the miserable monster's existence. Nice. Seems simple enough. You're the person pointing the gun out towards stuff in front of you, and you're the one who's going to be using it to enact extreme violence. This focus on immersive and high-octane first-person gameplay, rather than narrative and world-building, would be the nostalgic elements Doom 2016 invoked all those years later. Many people saw this almost as a triumphant act of defiance in the face of modern games that focused more and more on the latter. Simultaneously, these elements seemed to be less of a priority in Doom Eternal, resulting in claims that they were ruining the immersion and flow of the formula the series had established long ago. So, it would seem that a first-person shooter game in its purest form is something like the original Doom, then. It certainly delivers on that front in many ways. It is the ultimate power fantasy. You're just a badass guy carrying an inordinate amount of ammunition and weaponry, and you're here to turn demonic monsters into red paste and save the day. End of story. However, even this game, cited as a defining example of the first-person shooter, has features that contradict the central idea of an immersive first-person game. How could this be, though? Everything is shown from your perspective. That gun is your gun, that hand is your hand. You're the person running around this futuristic space facility overrun with demons, and you're the person chemically altering them into concentrated demon flesh vapor. Except not really, because that gun is not necessarily your gun, that hand is not necessarily your hand, and you're not necessarily the person whizzing around the space facility fighting demons, because even back in 1993, Doom was not a true immersive first-person experience, and neither are so many of the FPS games that came out in the following decades. It would be ahistorical to claim otherwise. There are major discrepancies that exist between the first-person perspective, meant to immerse the player into a role, and other stylistic elements of the game. If we look at Doom's UI, we clearly see the miniature portrait of a pale-skinned man with short tan hair, clearly meant to represent the person that you, the player, are controlling. That's the Doom guy, not you. When you pull out your fists as a melee weapon, you clearly see the hairy, bulky arms of a white man. While wielding other weapons, the arms of the character are still visible on screen as you reload weapons and run around, your limbs bobbing up and down. Observation of the portrait of this man reveals that it is a live portrait that changes and reacts to events in the game as they happen. He will look more and more bloodied as the player's health drops. His facial expressions are often ones of determination or careful awareness as he presses onwards in the adventure, resembling the typical unbreakable visages of tough male protagonists in the hypermasculine action movies and arcade games of the day. Doomguy's face becomes one of glee sometimes as he revels in the slaughter of his demonic foes during combat events. Perhaps nowadays, with gratuitous violence in mainstream action games being accepted as just the convention, we know what to expect when we jump right into an FPS game like this. It might not feel out of place at all for those of us playing it nowadays, yet Doom confidently portrayed itself as an ultra-violent power fantasy made explicitly for one specific audience, which is still a pretty typical thing to see today. That isn't to say that other demographics cannot enjoy the game or shouldn't enjoy the game and identify with Doomguy as the main protagonist, but it might be easier for some people than for others. After all, not every person playing Doom is a muscled-up white dude with a love for guns and bloodbath. And at the end of the day, he is clearly presented as his own separate character, contradicting the purpose of a pure, first-person immersive experience for people to insert themselves into. The experience of Doom could have been very different for different people if these contradictory factors weren't present. For example, it could have been more of a horrific tale of survival for one player had the portrait not revealed that the character enjoys the violence. All the way back in 1993, Doom could have been an experience much easier for people to insert themselves into had it been a first-person game without the aforementioned elements. The game itself is not the sole factor responsible for action games being often designed with white male audiences in mind, but it serves more as just an example of how, in more ways than one, its DNA as one of the first FPS games carried on in the decades that followed. Despite being played entirely in the first-person perspective, Doom 2016 is not purely immersive either. At the very start of the game, in the first few seconds, your white limbs are visible as you break free from your chains. BioShock is a game that is played entirely from the first-person perspective, even through cutscenes. However, the game immediately establishes, in the first seconds of the game, who you are, instead of letting you do that yourself. You are a somewhat jaded and gruff-sounding Caucasian man named Jack, with the color of your skin easily visible on your hands and arms throughout the experience. It's well known that the developers of Half-Life deliberately ensured that the main character did not speak, so as to better immerse the player into that role. Yet characters in-game refer to the player's character by his own established name and identity. This protagonist, Gordon Freeman, is also featured prominently on the game's cover box art as his own character.
About that beer I owed you. It's me, Gordon, Barney from Black Mesa. Hey, sorry for the scare, I had to put on a show for the cameras.
Of course, this question of how and which people can identify with video game protagonists can be made about games in general, whether or not the games they feature in are played with a first-person or third-person perspective. It reflects a broader question within popular media that is still being addressed today. This isn't to say that Doom or any of these games are objectively just bad games and shouldn't be played. And importantly, this isn't to say that games shouldn't tell stories about established characters separate from the player. After all, why do we watch movies or read books about other people? However, in a unique interactive medium like games, a first-person style perspective can be used, and often is used, to serve as the primary means of helping players put themselves into a game world. It is interesting to see, then, that this contradiction of doing that and simultaneously having to identify with an established other separate character has existed for a long time.